EMP series, The Exodus, entry number 7. Carl and Greg saw the bus coming and walked out of the woods into the road. After we picked them up, I brought them up to speed on what had happened since we dropped them off 2 days ago. This troubled Carl. He was coming to the realization that after all that had happened, the military would never stop looking for him. They would never stop coming for him and Greg, and anyone who was helping them along the way. By our estimation, we were about 60 miles from the DeMarco farm. In response to all that had transpired in the past 2 days, we switched to our alternate route, keeping off the main roads. It would take a little longer, but it was a necessary adjustment to avoid another checkpoint. We rolled onto the road leading into the DeMarco farm late in the afternoon. At the intersection with the dirt road, a sign hung between two old brick pillars. It simply stated the name DeMarco on it. Underneath it said "No Trespassing" in big, bold letters. There was an iron livestock gate closed across the driveway. Greg coasted to a stop and pulled the lever to swing the bus door open. When I stepped off to open the gate, two men armed with automatic rifles approached from the other side of the gate. One man stood back with his rifle in the low-ready position. The other walked up to the gate and said, "This is private property. State your business here," in a stern tone. Carl stepped off the bus and walked over to the guard. The guard recognized Carl, as he had been to Tony DeMarco's church on several occasions to fill in for the preacher when he was away doing his missions work abroad. After several minutes of talking, the guard swung the gate open and motioned the bus through. As it slowly rolled by, Carl stepped back aboard and instructed Greg where to go. The guard radioed ahead, and when we got to the end of the half-mile driveway, we were received by a small greeting party. Tony DeMarco at the head of the group. We were all assigned temporary quarters and unpacked our personal belongings and went to the large barn, which was used as a group hall. We had a wonderful meal and fellowship to follow. We were all very happy to have arrived safely and have the long trip behind us. After dinner, Carl brought Tony around to each member of our group and introduced him to everyone. He was very welcoming, and I felt as though we may have truly found a home here with him and his people. Carl and Tony then went off by themselves and talked for quite a while. When they were done, Carl and Tony stood and hugged each other. Tony walked off and up to the house to retire for the evening. Carl rejoined Greg and I at the table and pulled out a large manila document envelope. He looked at Greg as he opened it, said, "Greg, I have something for you. I've given this a great deal of thought, and please do not try to change my mind. This is really for the best for the group, and it's necessary." Greg looked at Carl and responded, "It sounds serious, Chief. What's up?" "Greg, after what has happened back home, I know, as I am sure you do also, that the military will never stop looking for us. It could be months or even years down the road, but one day, they will find us here. This envelope contains documents. Documents that I had to call in every favor ever owed from me from my friends at Section 7 to obtain. In these documents is a new life for you, Greg. New ID papers, including an old driver's license and Social Security card, as well as a new government issued ration and regional travel ID. Everything you need to bury your old identity forever." Greg took the top document from Carl and started to read it. Fred Wilkerson? He paused and looked at Carl. Really, Carl? Fred? That's the name you came up with? And Carl chuckled. No, Greg. Actually, they assigned it, not me. He chuckled harder as he thought of his friend and brother-in-arms. He looked at Greg and thought, Fred, that is kind of out of place for Greg. Neither one could picture Greg as a Fred. Carl kept smiling. Greg did not smile. He placed the document on the table. Carl, this isn't necessary. I think it is, Greg, Fred. I couldn't hold back the smile coming to my face either. Greg just glared over at me. And what name did they give you? Greg asked Carl. The smile dissipated from Carl's face as he answered, I'm not changing my identity, Greg. I'm leaving. There was a long silence at the table. Greg, they barely know you. Let your beard grow. Shave your head. Do whatever you can to change your appearance. They'll never recognize you. Assume the new identity and stay with the group. They need you. These papers are a new life for you, a new chance to wipe clean the slate and start over. You and Lee can have a happy life here together with these people. I spoke with Tony. He assures me everyone is welcome. Tomorrow, you're going to sit down with him and fill him in on everyone in the group, who they are, and what their experience and skill sets are. You will all be given jobs and places to live. New cabins will have to be built, so in the beginning, the accommodations might be tight. I assured him that you were up to the challenge. He could see Greg was not happy as he processed all that Carl had told him. He never imagined that this new start would not include Carl or his family. Where are you going to go, Carl? Carl looked at his friend. It's best if nobody knows, Greg. Abby and the girls and I will go off into the mountains. Several years ago, when we were coming here regularly to fill in at Tony's church, we fell in love with a beautiful tract of land in the mountains. We bought it and built a small cabin on it years ago. It was one of our bug-out contingency locations. We bought it under assumed identities, and nobody, not even Tony or his wife, know exactly where it is. It's far enough away from here to insulate you all from any problems that may follow us here. Yet, close enough to where we can ride in on horseback from time to time. So we will still be around, yet not part of the group on a day-to-day basis here at the farm. Greg pondered this for a moment. Okay, so I can ride out and help you when you need me to. Surely you can allow me to know where it is. After all we've been through, I know you can trust me. Of course I know that, Greg. But you cannot know where it is. I know that you realize that you can trust me, too. And right now, I need you to trust me on this. It's for the best. The best for you and for everyone. Please, Greg, this is hard enough. I need you to back me up when I tell the others. Greg just looked at Carl, not sure what to say. He simply nodded his head. Early the next morning, Carl packed two horses full of his family's belongings and saddled four horses. He loaded Abigail and the girls onto three of them. He mounted the fourth and led his family up into the mountains. As he prepared to turn a corner on the trail and disappear out of sight, he looked back over his shoulder one last time. Down by the bus, he saw Fred Wilkerson, the dear friend and comrade he knew as Greg. I was standing at his side, and together in unison, we snapped a crisp, firm salute to the man that we had come to know and respect, the man who had become our leader and our friend, the man who led us through the revolution and the journey here to safe haven. As Carl looked back and saw us there holding our salute, he simply waved and smiled at us. That was Carl's way of telling us that he was no longer the group leader, that we no longer answered to him, and that we no longer needed to salute him. We refused to drop the salute. That was Greg's way of letting Carl know that no matter what role he chose to assume for himself, that the respect and admiration he had for him did not waver. It did not and would not ever change. Carl smiled again as he returned our salute. He watched until we dropped the salute, and then he disappeared into the mountains.